If you've been on this channel for any amount of time, you'll know that it's become something of a little tradition around here to talk about the Haunted Mansion around Halloween time. Given its spooky theme and status as one of the most classic Disney attractions of all time, it's really just the perfect topic for this time of the year. But after last year's video on the mansion, we really exhausted just about every aspect of its history, going over everything from its design process to the special effects that it used, and even all of its old stories and characters that were lost back when they were still creating it. But there actually are still a few stories from the mansion that we haven't gone over yet, because they're stories that exist outside of the walls of the attraction, and instead, inside the grooves of mostly forgotten records. It shouldn't come as much of a surprise that when the Haunted Mansion finally opened in 1969, and became overwhelmingly popular in the following years, Disney was the first to try and capitalize on its success, whether it was through selling model kits of various characters from the ride, or even making board games based on it. There was plenty of weird merchandise surrounding the mansion all throughout the 1970s. But probably the most interesting stuff to come out of that era were the records, just for some of their unique connections to the ride, and the way they reimagined parts of it for the new medium. So this video is going to be all about those records, not only how they came into existence in the first place, but also the stories that they told, and how those stories relate back to the ride itself. So let's go ahead and get into it. Before we start talking about some of the more Haunted Mansion specific stuff here, I want to start us off with something kinda unrelated. That being a record called the Thrilling, Chilling Sounds of the Haunted House. First released back in 1964, the album actually predates the attraction by about 5 years. So you're really not gonna find any direct links between the ride and the record, like some of the other ones we'll be talking about. But it does set the stage for all of them. It might actually have a connection or two to the attraction's development, which was happening right around the same time. Now, as far as the record itself goes, it's really just a collection of various scary sound effects that Disney had compiled from and for all their different animated films over the years, now releasing them as a standalone LP. And as such, it featured just about every kind of spooky Halloween sound you could possibly want, from howling winds to clanking chains, as well as all kinds of screams and other ghostly noises too. It was sounds like these that Disney Foley artists like Jimmy MacDonald had been creating since the 1930s, and would continue to do all the way through the 70s, even contributing a few iconic sounds to the Haunted Mansion during his tenure. And while he isn't outright credited anywhere for the album, it's safe to say that he likely had something to do with it, or at least some of the sounds that they used on it. And interestingly, while we're already on the mansion, certain parts of this thing actually remind me a lot of similar unofficial records that Ken Anderson would use during his early Haunted Mansion idea pitch meetings back in 1957, where he'd use recordings of creepy ambience from Disney's sound effects library to help get across the atmosphere and feel of his original mansion. Anyway, going back to the actual record, the only thing that really sets it apart from just being a whole bunch of miscellaneous horror sounds playing randomly was the fact that they were broken up into separate 1 to 3 minute tracks that each told their own little story. For example, the sounds I was playing earlier were from the first one, called The Haunted House, which, like every other story on this thing, started off with an introduction from the narrator, Laura Olsher, who would kind of set the tone for the story, and then let your mind take over once the effects kicked in.
High on a hilltop near your home, there stands a dilapidated old mansion. Some say the place is haunted, but you don't believe in such myths. One dark and stormy night, you decide to investigate, and you never return.
And by taking a look at the rest of the track list, it becomes pretty apparent that the record really doesn't have much to do with haunted houses, despite the name. Because beyond its first story, they really end up taking this thing in all types of different directions, with stories about black cats, a ship crashing into shore, and someone blowing themselves up with dynamite. You know, just one of those classic explosive haunted houses. But what's really strange is that some of those themes are surprisingly similar to the stuff that Mark Davis would later use for his stretching and changing portraits. It's probably a coincidence, but certainly not impossible that he could have taken some inspiration from the album, especially considering the thing was released by Disney right around the same time that he was first getting involved in the project. But really, aside from that, you won't find much else relating to the mansion on the record itself. However, there is still a pretty big connection between the two, and it actually comes with the picture on the album's cover. Originally painted by Disney artist Paul Wenzel, there have been some rumors over the years that it was actually created as a piece of early concept art for the attraction, that they later repurposed as album art. And while that may or may not be true, it really doesn't matter, because it does still say something that they went with a piece so similar to what the final house ended up looking like. You might remember that I said earlier that this thing was first released back in 1964, and 1964 was also a pretty important year for the attraction as well, since that's when they finally finished building its facade at the park. Of course, the actual ride was still years away at that point, due to delays brought on by the New York World's Fair, but the construction of the house itself was what really got people looking forward to the attraction. And I think having such a similar looking house on the album's cover was probably intentional, as some kind of cross promotion, despite the two not really having much to do with each other. And if that was the thought process behind the decision, it definitely worked, because the semi-obscure record actually had a resurgence in sales after the ride opened in 1969, eventually leading to the album going gold in 1972, which was pretty rare for one of these kinds of records. And, as a result, it was then re-released the next year, with a slightly redesigned orange cover, and some spooky party hints apparently included as a bonus, which was really just a slip of paper with some little Halloween party ideas and games to play. Although you might notice some familiar Haunted Mansion characters on that sheet as well, like the Raven, the Executioner, and the Opera Singer, once again reaffirming the idea that they were trying to incorporate some aspects of the ride into this re-release. Aside from all that though, I will still say that the record is pretty good as just a standalone piece of media, and I would also give it a recommendation to Haunted Mansion fans, because despite the lack of outright connections, they did manage to capture that sort of morbid humor and macabre theme that the ride is so well known for, even just through the use of narration and sound effects.
You thought there was going to be a huge explosion, didn't you?
Plus, the second side of this thing is just the creepy sounds without any narration. Perfect for setting the mood at a Halloween party, telling a scary story, or just getting into that spooky holiday spirit. Tons of fun either way. But that was all just a little warm-up, because our next record, the story and song from the Haunted Mansion, is actually going to take us inside the ride, only now with a few very interesting changes. As the first one of these records to actually be released after the Haunted Mansion opened, it's also the first one to kind of reuse the attraction's storyline too. Really, at its core, the story and song LP can basically be considered the ride in audio form, since it hits on all the same plot points and scenes that you would have went through in the ride, now beautifully described by narrator Thurl Ravenscroft.
Have you ever seen a haunted house? You know the kind I mean. That old dark house that's usually at the end of a dimly lit street. The owners haven't been seen for years. No one really knows why.
The story now follows that of two teenagers, Mike and Karen, who find themselves locked in an abandoned house late at night, after seeking shelter in it from a rainstorm.
This old porch isn't going to keep us dry, though.
What are you doing?
Trying to get the front door open. No one lives here. We can wait inside until the storm's over.
Not me. I'm not going in that old house. I'd rather stay out here and get wet.
There. Come on, don't be afraid.
From there, they realize they can only escape it by going through the rest of the house, and, in turn, all of the scenes that we know and love from the attraction. It's really a creative way of taking a ride with basically no conclusive storyline at all, and giving us a simple narrative and characters to experience it through, with our two teenagers, voiced by Robbie Lesser and Ron Howard of all people. But what's even more interesting is that the record is missing the original voice of Paul Frees as the ghost host, now replacing him with voice actor Peter Renaday, which is odd, considering the fact that most of his lines are still taken directly from the attraction's original script.
Welcome, foolish mortals, to the haunted mansion. I am your host, your ghost host. Kindly step this way. You will not be harmed, but you will not be released until you take a tour of my home.
It makes you wonder why they didn't just reuse the original audio, since that's what they did with Eleanor Audley's famous lines for Madame Leota, who also makes an appearance in this. Anyway, from there, the ghost host then guides the two through part of the pre-show, including the stretching room, portrait gallery, and what would be the ride's loading area, now just described as an otherworldly boundless realm, with a staircase leading into the rest of the attraction.
As they climbed to the second floor, they were greeted by an appalling cold. And this, as you know, is the traditional manifestation of the supernatural.
After that, they get into the actual ride part of the attraction, and the storyline ends up just following its layout pretty much to a T, as they encounter a spirit in the endless hallway, and run through the corridor of doors.
Where do we go from here? How do we get out of this horrible place?
This seems to be the main corridor. Let's hope it leads to a back staircase and a way out.
Now might be a good time to mention that I'm pretty sure some of the background sounds on this thing are straight off the tracks from that Thrilling Chilling album from earlier, just for how similar they all sound. And it really wouldn't be all that surprising either, since they were both pulling from the same sound effects library at Disney. I mean, seriously, how many different tracks do you really need of wind, rain, and rattling chains? Eventually, though, our two characters end up meeting Madame Leota conducting her seance, and subsequently find themselves on a balcony overlooking the ballroom, where they then see all of the ghosts begin to materialize. But things don't get particularly interesting until they reach the attic, and come across a few rather unique ghosts.
This is crazy! I don't believe what I see! Why did we ever come in this house?
There's a door at the end of the balcony. Come on!
The first spirit they see in there is the Beating Heart Bride, one of the original characters from the mansion.
Mike and Karen entered the door and came face to face with a ghost dressed as a bride. She was strangely illuminated, and her heart glowed red with each heartbeat.
In the attraction, she would stare ominously at riders, as her heartbeat creepily echoed throughout the attic. But since it's been open, however, the bride has been redesigned countless times over the years, and now actually exists as an entirely new character these days. So, her inclusion in the record is really fun to see, but not as much fun as the next spirit who appears in that scene, the famous Hatbox Ghost.
And as they turned to run out of the door, another ghostly manifestation appeared and blocked their way. He was a cloaked figure with an evil, grinning face. A hatbox hung from his hand. With each beat of his bride's heart, his head disappeared from his body and appeared in the hat box.
Another one of the original characters from the mansion, or was intended to be one at least, the Hatbox Ghost has got one of the most interesting histories out of anybody else in the attraction. Back before the ride opened, he was developed as another one of Mark Davis's sort of gag characters. Just a ghost whose head would disappear off his body and pop back up in the hatbox he was holding. Eventually, the concept was made into an actual animatronic, even complete with a disappearing head effect developed by Yale Gracie, which eventually made its way into the attraction itself, a few months before its original opening. But he was ultimately removed in late 1969, due to some technical problems with the effect, and didn't reappear until 2015, now as a new figure altogether. So, to see him pop up on this thing is a real treat, and just shows how closely the story was tied to that original mansion. After that, our two characters climb through a window and make their way down some balcony steps, leading them into the graveyard.
Our adventurous pair descended the steps to the ground level and began their walk through the private burial grounds, trying to find their way out of this living nightmare. They passed an old caretaker holding a lantern, too frightened to speak. His dog was cowering at his feet, whimpering.
And began to vocalize, grim, grim ghosts come out to socialize.
As you might expect, the famous Grim Grinning Ghost song from the attraction begins to play, as they look for a way out of the cemetery, passing by all the different ghosts from that scene. And eventually, our protagonists manage to find their way into a crypt, which they end up escaping through just like in the ride, ending our story. Like I said earlier, this record really didn't stray too far from its source material, and it basically just converted the ride experience into an audiobook. But back when it first came out, it actually did pretty well, not only as just a promotional item that was released right alongside Disney's most anticipated attraction of its time, but also as a souvenir for people who already went on it too, as a way to kind of re-experience the ride later on at home. Plus, the LP also came with a bunch of really nice illustrations done by Colin Campbell, depicting various scenes from the attraction. These were all bundled with the record's sleeve, and the whole thing actually doubled as a little book that you could kinda use to read along with, an idea that we'll be coming back to here in a minute. And much like the thrilling Chilling album from earlier, the story and song also saw its fair share of re-releases over the years too. In addition to the original LP, an edited down version of the story was also released in 1974. Now as the B-side for Walt Disney's Trick or Treat record, which itself was just the retelling of the 1952 animated short. So, I'm guessing that reusing the story there was just an attempt to kind of pad out the runtime of that record, since the first side only ended up being about 12 minutes on its own. After that though, the original unedited version of the story was re-released on tape in 1998. Only now retitled as A Spooky Night in Disney's Haunted Mansion, which was odd, considering the fact that cassettes were pretty much obsolete by the late 90s, and the story didn't get an official CD release until 2011. But luckily, that version also brought back the Colin Campbell illustrations too, which hadn't seen a fresh reprinting since the 1970s, probably making this the best version out there. But we've still got one record left, and it's actually a read-along record with its story based on the attraction. Back in the mid-1960s, Disney began releasing a series of these read-along LPs. In most cases, these were just quick 5 to 8 minute stories that came narrated on vinyl, and also gave you a little booklet that had the story in it too, most of the time with some additional artwork. And while they were by no means the most popular thing in the world back then, Disney actually ended up putting out quite a few of them, usually based on pre-existing stories. So, when the Haunted Mansion opened in the late 1960s, right when these things were still in style, you can bet that they used it as the basis for a new one. Officially released back in 1970, this thing really wasn't all that special on its own. And much like the story and song record, it really just retold the ride storyline again. In fact, I think this version might actually be kind of based on that previous record, since it makes it a point to cover almost the exact same scenes as well. Only now, with the key difference being its target audience. Because unlike our two previous albums, which were both meant for teenagers and older kids, this one was pretty clearly made for younger children, just judging by its art style and the way that its story was presented. You know, some more simplistic designs and some nice smiling ghosts that were friendly, not creepy. Plus, the whole tone of the narration is a lot more upbeat and not as serious as the last one.
I entered the open front door and was greeted by a ghostly voice. Good evening. Welcome to the Haunted Mansion. The voice seemed to be coming from the art gallery. Good evening, I said in a shaky voice. Do you mind my being here? Not at all, the voice replied. We have so few visitors. May I show you around?
Side note, you might notice that the narrator on this thing is actually Robie Lester again, who played Karen in the previous story. No sign of Ronnie Howard, though. I guess he was too busy at Arnold's drive-in by then. Other than that, though, there really isn't too much to say about this album, because even just describing its plot would pretty much just be me going over the same stuff from Part 2. After listening to them both a couple times, I'm about 90% sure that this thing was just the kids' adaptation of that story and song record that they simplified and released a year later.
I turned to run out of the attic, but another image blocked my way. He was a large, cloaked figure whose head disappeared from his shoulders and appeared in a hatbox he held in his hand.
Only now with a lot less production involved too, since it's only got the one narrator. But even still, I am gonna recommend it, because you just can't beat the quaint factor of a kids' Disney record from the 70s, especially when it's about the Haunted Mansion. And I'm even gonna leave you a link in the description to an interactive version, just so you can get that full-on page-turning experience.
I am going to begin now to read the story of The Haunted Mansion. You can read along with me in your book. You will know it is time to turn the page when Tinkerbell rings her little bells like this.
Ugh, absolutely classic. Well, that just about wraps things up for this video. And I do seriously want to recommend you giving these albums a listen, if you're a big Haunted Mansion fan, that is, since they all offer a unique take on, or presentation of the ride, which I definitely enjoyed, especially through such an old medium like records. For whatever reason, the two complement each other nicely, and really bring that creepy old vintage feel out of the mansion, which you don't often get too much of these days.
I have to go now. It's midnight. Pleasant dreams.
Before the Haunted Mansion opened up, it was one of the most eagerly anticipated. We put a lid on it, please.
Let me out.